Hello, I'm Manuel Castro. I'm professor in the Spanish University for Distance Education in the UNED, and we are one partner of the IOE-EQ, Internet of Energy Education and Qualification Project, and we will present this webinar today together with the IEEE Spanish section and the IEEE Spanish chapter of the Education Society. We will present the webinar Electric Vehicles and their Integration on the Electric Grid through the Internet of Energy, presented by Jesús Fraile Ardanuey, from the Universidad Politécnica de Madrid, the Madrid Polytechnical University.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I have switched off the camera in order to have more bandwidth. And welcome to my presentations. Okay. As Manuel told us, I am an associate professor at Telecommunication Engineering School in the Technical University of Madrid. And my research lines are related to develop control system algorithms applied to renewable energies, and we also are working on the integration of electric vehicles on the grid. Well, let's start with the presentation. I have divided the presentation in four different parts. The first one will be a brief introduction to electric power system. Then I will talk about electric vehicles. And the third point will be the relationship between electric vehicles and electric power system. I will finish my presentation with a novel peer-to-peer energy trading market with electric vehicles, which is the core of the presentation. So let's start. The first is asking a question: why electricity is held in low esteem? I think that is because it's always there, it's cheap, and usually nobody worry about it until the light goes out. It's a little bit slow. Well, electrical power system are the backbone of modern life, and if there is any problem in this system, it will affect a million people. Here I present some data from different blackouts in the world. The biggest one was in India on July 2012, affecting 670 billion people in almost a week. So it's important to notice the impact of electric power system on our life. The power system generates, transports and distributes electric energy to the consumers. The electricity is generated in the power plants on the left, and usually these power plants are located far away from the populated area, so we have to transport all this energy to the consumers. The generators generate three-phase alternating current with constant frequency and voltage, and this voltage is a step up here in the transformers. To higher voltage before the connection to the transmission network. These high voltage transmission lines, Prudencio, would you please connect your microphone?
Sí.
Okay. yes, we step up the voltage here in the transformer. To connect the power plants to the transmission lines. These transmission lines are in the range of 110 to 400 kilovolts, with a typical maximum distance around 300, 400 kilometers. So the energy is transported to the transmission station, and then the voltage is stepped down. And the energy is distributed in medium voltage for here, for the industrial consumer, or in low voltage for the residential or domestic consumers. The energy flows from the left to the right, is from the generation to the consumers, and the delta comes in the opposite direction, from the consumers to the utility. Okay. Well, going a little bit deeper in the generation side, Electric power starts at the power plant, and in almost all cases, the power plant consists of a generator called alternator or synchronous machine. The rotor of the generator has an adjustable magnet, so here in the figure, and this rotor is turned by a primer mover called turbine, producing a rotating magnetic field inside the machine. And this rotating magnetic field induces three-phase voltages in these windings. We have the red one, the green one, and the blue one. And these windings are located in the stator of the generator. The speed of the turbine is adjusted continuously to keep voltage frequency constant, and also the voltage amplitude is controlled to keep it inside the limits. Here we have a hydropower plant, like an example of how we can convert potential energy stored in the dam, is transformed into mechanical energy when the water goes through the penstock, hitting the blades of the turbine. The turbine is connected to the generator. The generator transforms this mechanical energy into electrical energy. And the voltage of the generator is a step up in this transformer to connect with the high voltage transmission lines, as we have been seeing in the previous slide. Well, one of the main characteristics of the power consumption is the difference between the demand during the day and during the weekdays and even during the season. In the night, the consumption is the lowest, and then when we get up, the consumption starts to rise, and it reaches the maximum value at the end, usually at the end of the day, when all of us came back home and start cooking and turning on all the lights, etc. So, as you can see here, the demand is not constant, it's variable. The problem here is that we don't have a storage capacity in the grid, so the grid operator needs to balance power supply and the demand all times. And this is done using adjusting the generation side. There are different types of power plants to cover all this variable demand. And a mix of different generation technologies is used instead of using a single one, because this solution is more flexible and it provides the most cost-effective solution. Nuclear and coal power plants are the base load power plants, and they are operating all times at constant nominal power. This type of plants has very high fixed cost. That means that it's very expensive to build them, but they have very low marginal cost, which means that it's very cheap to produce energy with this base load power plants. In the other side, we have peak load plants that are operating only during high demand periods, and they have low capital cost and high variable cost. In this example, big hydropower plants and combined cycle gas turbines power plants usually are used as peak power plants. In order to promote renewable energy, it is common to use to try to cover the demand with renewable energies. And here we are representing the demand in red and renewable energy in green. And as you can see here, we have a difference between both curves, which is called residual load. This residual load is covered usually by different conventional sources, usually gas power plants. And if you analyze this in this part of the curve, you can see here that we have more renewable energy than demand. So in some moments, we can have problems with this intermittent renewable energy. Why? Because we cannot adjust the production of renewable energies, and sometimes, especially during the night, if the demand is very low and the generation is very high, we can have to disconnect the renewable energy, because we cannot consume all the energy that we are generating in this moment. So here we have a clear example of that. This is called a spilled wind or solar, but usually it's a spill because it's sorry, it's a wind energy because it's produces during the night. And you see in the graph that the wind power is disconnected when the generation is higher than the demand. In this case, we are losing this renewable energy because we don't have the opportunity to store this energy. In order to solve this problem, we have different balancing solutions. The first one is to increase interconnections in the transmission network with other countries, allowing to send this surplus of energy to France or Portugal or Morocco in the case of Spain. There is a European program to develop a fully interconnected European electricity market in the following years. So we are promoting the installation of new transmission lines. And the other option is the energy management. We have divided this energy management in two different points, the demand response and energy storage. Electric vehicles can work in both energy management systems. Well, related to energy management, as we have seen before, a system operator acts over power plants to balance the variable demand. But when we have variable power plants, like the intermittent renewables, the option is to modify the other side, the demand. So DSM or demand side management are related to all activities that influence on the customer use of electricity. There are two different types of DSM. One is a direct DSM, which means that the distribution system operator act directly to the load side, connecting or disconnecting the load. For example, in this example, the DSO can send a binary message to this building to switch on or off the lights. And the other option is to modify the power that the consumer are using in this moment. For example, in California, there is a problem, there is a program where the users can get some discounts in their electricity tariff, allowing the DSO to modify the set point of their air conditioning remotely. So they can modify the amount of energy that they are consuming. The other solution is indirect DSM, which means that we are modifying the customer's behavior through a variation on the electricity price. The user acts according to the variation of the electricity price. But this second option is, for sure, is less flexible. There are three different types of demand-side management actions. One is peak saving, which means that we are proposing a reduction of customer loads during the peak demand periods. And this is done using a direct control of a customer appliance. This is a clear example of direct DSM. The other thing is conservation, which means that we can reduce the consumption of the customer. And usually this is done using more efficient appliances. Also, we can install solar panels, for example, at home. And then from the DSO point of view, they will see a reduction of the consumption of the consumer. So if we install PV panels at home, the effect is a reduction in the consumption. And finally, we have load shifting. It's shifting loads from on-peak periods to off-peak periods. So we are moving the consumption from one point to the other. The other solution is to store the energy. We could store the energy during the off-peak periods. We have signed the off-peak periods here in yellow, and we store this energy and use it in the on-peak periods. avoiding the connection of peak power plants, which are the most expensive ones. Okay. There are different solutions to store energy, pump hydropower plants, batteries, flywheels, supercapacitors, there are many of others. But pump hydropower plants accounts are around 99% of the all available storage globally. Lithium batteries, which is the main power source for most home electronics devices, are now using also in the power grid. So a lot of people are working on the develop of new electrochemical batteries to store energy for electric vehicles and to provide security supply to regional or even national electricity networks. So in the following slides, we will talk a little bit about how the electric vehicles can contribute to support the electric grid. So let's start with the beginning. At the beginning is the definition. What is an electric vehicle? Well, an electric vehicle is a vehicle that uses one or more electric motors for propulsion instead of use an internal combustion engine. Electric vehicles can be powered using a collector system like in the trains or trams, or they can be self-contained using a battery or a generator to convert fuel to electricity. For example, when you are using a fuel cell for propulsion in electric vehicles. The vehicle classification, we can divide it in three different points. The first one is the conventional car. We have an internal combustion engine with fuel and transmission. The second one is a mix, is the hybrid electric vehicles. Let me. Okay. Oh, sorry. Here, the hybrid electric vehicles that we have a battery and electric motor, and also in parallel we have an internal combustion engine and fuel. And finally, the battery electric vehicles. In this case, we don't have an internal combustion engine. So, related specifically to electric vehicles, the first example is hybrid vehicle. It has an internal combustion engine, usually fueled by gasoline. There are some examples using diesel and compressed natural gas, and they also have an electric motor that can also work like a generator. This vehicle has a small battery pack, and this battery pack is recharged only by regenerative braking. The battery is very small, so the range in an electric mode is very low, around 2 to 5 kilometers, and the batteries cannot be recharged using external charging, so you cannot plug in the vehicle to the grid. The internal combustion engine is more powerful than the electric motor, and there are different types of hybrid. The next evolution is plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. Again, we have internal combustion engine and electric motor, but the battery here is a little bit bigger. So we can recharge this battery using regenerative braking or using external charging. Because we have larger battery, the range is also bigger, so the range is around 25 to 50 kilometers. And again, the internal combustion engine is bigger than the electric motor. A variation of plug-in hybrid electric vehicles is extended plug-in hybrid vehicles, which they have a bigger battery, allowing to drive the daily trips with in electric mode. So this is around 50 to 100 kilometers. And in this case, the electric motor is bigger than the internal combustion engine. The internal combustion engine is only used to recharge the battery, but is not used for propulsion of the vehicle. And the last option is to avoid have an internal combustion engine. So the car only has the electric vehicles and a big battery. And depending of the nominal battery capacity, you have different ranges. I have put here different values for different models, but the main problem here is that you don't have a plan B if you are out of battery. It's the same that if you have problems with your fuel in a combustion car. Well, we are going to see the advantages and disadvantages of this type of vehicles. The advantages are clear. The electric vehicles are more efficient. They have lower energy costs compared to oil. They have lower emission depending on the country, but it's easier to control emission, and the power plants that millions of Taipeis in the city centers. So even that you can generate the electricity using coal or in thermal power plants, for example, the air quality in the cities are better if you are using electric vehicles, because you are not using, you are not emitting these emissions in the city. Also, you have an important noise reduction, which is very important for the cities. And the electric motors are very simple, so the maintenance of these cars is cheaper. The main drawbacks of the electric vehicles are related with the battery. The battery is very heavy, is very big, and it requires a lot of time to be recharged. So the cars are heavier. The battery is still very expensive, so you have a high initial cost compared to a conventional car. Also, the battery life worry to the consumers, because it's something that can deteriorate. So people is affected for this point. And the last point is the integration of the electric vehicles in the grid. Okay, if we have done a great deployment of electric vehicles, we will have enough energy to recharge of all these vehicles or not. Well, we will see in the following slides. Related to the charging process, there are different types of charging sockets. And you can charge at different power. The higher is the power, the lower is the charging time. You can charge the electric vehicles in AC, the first three options is in AC, or with a high power DC connections. The two right sockets are related to these DC sockets. There are other options for different type of vehicles, not for cars, but yes, for trucks, using something similar to trains. Like you can see here with rails, you can connect in the road, or here in the on the left, you can see the pantograph system to connect the vehicle to the lines. And the other option is to do it using a wireless charging method. There are two of them. One, well, the wireless charging process is very simple. You have two coils, one inside the road, and the other is installed in the vehicle. And you have a magnetic coupling of both coils. On the left, you see the static wireless charging, which requires the vehicle has to be stopped. And the other is a dynamic charging, a wireless charging method, in which the vehicle can be recharged when it is traveling in this special road.
The vehículo eléctrico.
Sorry? Ah, okay. Well, I follow. It's important to know what is an electric vehicle when it's driving. When driving an electric vehicle, it must be performed like a conventional car, meeting driver's expectation for mobility, performance, and safety standards. But when an electric vehicle is plug-in, It's an electric load like any other appliance, like computer or a microwave oven or a fridge. But the difference here is that it can constitute also a smart electric load, so they can be charged when it's required, and also it can be store energy and give it back when it's required. So it's more flexible. If an electric vehicle is charged without any control, probably people will try to recharge the vehicle as soon as they arrive at home. And as we have seen before, the peak demand is produced when we arrive at home. So if we don't control the charging process, we will see that we will need to connect more peak power plants. So this will affect the electricity price, and they have more consequences that we will analyze in the following slide. Let me see here. From the generation point of view, if we don't control the EV charging, we will increase the generation capacity and we will have to use peaking plants. The impact of that will be that the electricity price will be higher, and we also increase the CO2 emissions. From the transmission level point of view, some congestion could happen, but this is not very a very important problem. The problem usually came from the distribution level. Probably we will need to reinforce the network. You can have also problems derived by the harmonics produced by the chargers in the transformers. And then you can have local problems in the distribution network. From the consumer point of view, you probably have to increase your contracted power, so you will have to pay a little bit more. And depending on your installation, it's probably you will need to reinforce your connection. But if you recharge your vehicle interacting with the power system, you can have a smart load, and instead of producing problems, you can solve some problems that the electric grid have. What we can do here? Well, we can, for example, try to flat the consumption curve, helping to integrate more renewable energies during the night. So if we recharge during the valley hours, this is an advantage for the system. For example, how many cars could we integrate in the Spanish grid right now? Well, assuming that a conventional electric vehicle has a battery of 40 kilowatt hours of capacity, and assuming that this is a normal, this is the demand of one specific day. The maximum value is 55 gigawatts here at more or less 10 o'clock. We can try to fill this gap in green. This gap has an area of 122 gigawatts hour. And we can try to recharge during these periods in order to fill this gap using electric vehicles. So we could do is this. I don't know why it's going so slow, but the point here is that we could cover the demand of 3.05 million vehicles charging during these periods of time. Another step further than smart charging is called a vehicle to grid. Vehicle to grid is that electric vehicles can be used as distributed storage devices, feeding back the electricity that has been stored before in their batteries. Electric vehicles can power a house for 1 or 2 days. This action were done in Japan when the Fukushima problem, and they could also provide the grid with ancillary services that could generate revenue for the AV owner, so they can help the grid. Analyzing in the same way that we have done before from the generation level, if we do a smart charging of electric vehicles, we can reduce the price of the electricity, we can integrate renewable energies, and we can reduce CO2 emissions. From the transmission level, we can support the TSO to manage the congestion, providing frequency regulation services. From the distribution level, we can also control the voltage in the low voltage and medium voltage network, support providing reactive power support. And also, we can help to reduce or postpone the network. From the consumer point of view, the electric vehicle is really expensive, so we can reduce the mobility cost by selling flexibility services to the grid. And also, it's possible to use the electric battery to provide vehicle to home or vehicle to building services. This is two examples of real vehicle-to-grid application that are working on the U.S. The first one is from eMotors Berkeley in California, where the drivers are paid when they are plugging, they are connected to the grid. And the other is an application in Colombia. It's called Grid on Wheels, that they are providing ancillary services for the TSO, which is PAM in Colombia State. So I think that with all this introduction, you have a background to understand what we did in the DataSync project. This is a European project that we were involved some time ago, and the objective of this project was to provide a new and highly detailed spatio-temporal micro-simulation methodology for human mobility. This methodology was based on massive amounts of big data from different sources, from GPS traces, mobile phones, social network, and the goal of the project was to forecast the mobility and the impact of massive deployment of electric vehicles given the relationship between mobility and power distribution network. Our colleagues from Hasselt University in Belgium developed an activity-based mobility model called FEEDERS. This model generates activity schedules for a synthetic population in Flanders region based on different information. For each member of this synthetic population, FEEDERS develop a daily agenda, which consists of a sequence of episodes, each of which contains exactly one trip, followed by a different activity. And in this case, we consider more than 1 million members who travel by car in this region. For example, this particular member was located in area A, in yellow, at 7 o'clock in the morning, and then he goes to work at region B in green. He works from 9 to 5, and we have all the information. We know where he is, when he's moving, what all the population is doing, when they are traveling from one point to the other, and what is the available distance, the daily distance that they are traveling per day. The thing that we did was to segment the user. So we have three different sets. Set A is the first one, is composed by all the drivers who can complete their daily activity schedule using their electric vehicles without performing any intermediate charging during the day. So they start their activities in the morning, they have recharged their vehicles during the night, and at the end of the day, they have a surplus of kilowatt hours stored in their batteries at the end. Set B is the second set, and consists of those drivers who can complete their daily activities without modifying their mobility behavior, but these electric vehicles will require to be recharged during the day. In this case, this vehicle will be parked at work, so they can recharge during the working hours, and then they can reach their final destination going back home at the end of the day. And finally, there is a third set, which is set C, and it consists of those drivers who cannot complete the daily trips without modifying their daily mobility behavior. So they are traveling a lot, or they don't stop enough time to recharge. Related to that, it's important to see here that all the drivers from set B must charge their vehicles during the day, and the price of the electricity during the day is more expensive than during the night. So they will charge a minimum amount of energy to reach the final destination. So they don't recharge, they don't fully recharge their batteries, only recharge a little bit to reach the final destination. It's possible to quantify the distribution of surplus energy stored in the batteries of set A and the additional energy demanded by vehicles from set B. Okay. Sorry. Well, here I am presenting the energy surplus, which is the all energy stored in all vehicles from this set A. And here is the energy demanded. Okay. This is the energy demanded by all vehicles from set B. As you can see here, it's more than 30,000 vehicles from this set. It will require less than 6 kWh, which is very, very low. And we have here in the energy surplus from set A, we have around 35 times more energy stored in these batteries than the energy required. So the idea here is to connect vehicles from set A to vehicles to set B and share their energy. The first thing that we have done is understand when the people of set B must share their vehicles. We propose an optimization algorithm, but we are not going inside the equations. The idea here is, okay, here we have, in this graph, we have things. The first thing is the electricity price, is shown in green. The other thing is the battery state of charge, which is this blue line, and the different colors of the backgrounds means that this vehicle is stopped or is parked in different areas. So as you can see here, at the beginning of the day, the battery state of charge is maximum, and when they travel from one area to other area, the energy is decreasing, the energy stored in the battery decrease. But in order to reach the final destination, this vehicle must be recharged during this first stop. And if you analyze the electricity price, you will see that the electricity price is very slow in the first hour. So he charged his vehicle in this moment. Again, if we analyze all the cure, we will see that there is a second trip, and then this vehicle is recharged during this low period of electricity price. We can add all the information. We can aggregate the information of the energy required by all these vehicles, allowing to get the total energy demanded in each zone and in each time period. Here we have, for a particular area, we have a temporal variation of the electric demand. This is the electricity price, the green line, and the blue one is the total energy demanded for a specific region during a day. And the second graph here is the spatial representation of the electric demand. Well, analyzing the activities that are the people are doing when they need to recharge their vehicles, we will see that there are two options. Most of the people are at home or at work when it's optimal for them to perform this required intermediate recharge. But in some specific areas, people require charging when they are doing other activities. For example, here they are doing shopping. So this really is very interesting because it can help different policymakers to promote a specific rollout of the charging points. You don't put charging points wherever you want. You have a specific knowledge about what is the best solution in order to do this rollout of charging points. And the other thing that we propose is in order to avoid that these vehicles charge directly from the grid, is take the advantage that you have vehicles at the same time and in the same area. One of them has a surplus of energy and the other has a lack of energy, so you can share the energy from one point to the other. In this case, the we have done is collect all the available information about the offer and the demand among vehicles, and an aggregator determines an optimal peer-to-peer price per area and per time slot, allowing customers with a surplus of energy in their batteries to share this energy with the other user who need to charge their vehicles during the day. I don't know. Okay, here it is. So the idea is that you can connect both type of vehicles in the same moment at the same time. The first idea was to use a common DC bus to connect both type of vehicles, but the same that you can share the battery from one Samsung mobile phone to the other. There are some prototypes from Toyota like this that these vehicles can share the energy from one vehicle to the other. They have a winding on the side of the vehicle and they can put in together, but not connecting via using a cable. They can share the energy using a wireless communication. So this is the proposal for that. In this case, in this slide, we have seen the effects of this proposal in both type of vehicles. On the left, you have the same example of the previous slide. When, sorry. Here. On the left, this is the same example that on the previous slide. This is a car from set. Okay, set P, and if you see the green line is the price from the grid, the blue one is the state of the charge of the battery, and the black line is the price proposed by this peer-to-peer interchange. And you can see here that this vehicle can charge at this price, is around 20, a little bit lower than 30 euros per megawatt hour. It's very is cheaper than the price from the grid. Again, here in the second chart, the price that he has to pay is cheaper than the price directly from the grid. And the other graph on the right is the application of the peer-to-peer trading system from the perspective of an electric vehicle from set A. This vehicle travels a very short daily trip and it has a surplus of energy to share. So this energy is shared to other vehicles in three different types of the day. Well, depending of the ratio between energy demanded and the energy required in each area and each time zone, you have different prices. And here, this is the example. Now, the black line represents the electricity price from the grid, and we have represented the price in different areas of Flanders region. For example, in the blue line represent an area, this zone 2350, in which there are more vehicles willing to sell energy than vehicles willing to buy energy. So the electricity price is very low during all the day. In the other zone, in the red one, zone 1824, the electricity, there are a lot of vehicles willing to buy energy, and there is a scarcity of vehicles who want to sell energy. And in this case, the peer-to-peer price will increase and reach the maximum value, which is the value of the electricity from the grid. So even in that point, at 10 o'clock, they pay the same price that electricity grid, but the rest of the day, the money that they have to pay for the electricity is lower. So as the main conclusion, we have analyzed the power system, the electric vehicles, and the interaction between these two services. And we have proposed a novel peer-to-peer energy trading system that allows to reduce the impact of electric vehicle charging on the power grid during the peak periods. That generates an additional benefit for users, providing revenues for some of them and reducing the transportation electricity cost for the others. And finally, a reflection. When I was young, smoking was allowed in the restaurant, but now smoking is banned in restaurants. And I think that it will happen in the same in the cities. Conventional cars will be banned and inner cities and everything, the future will be electric. So thank you so much for your attention, and if you have any question, I will try to answer.
Thank you very much, Jesus. We'll have some time for some questions there. If you'd like to make some question, please put on your speaker and you can do it. Please, Jesus, if you could please put your video to
yes
in the recording. Perfect. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Adrian.
I will make one between we wait for some people there.
Yeah.
What do you believe that the future using this kind of Internet of Things working together and being really peer to peer between the cars should be feasible in 5 years, for example?
Well, not in 5 years. For sure.
Yes, I suppose it is.
No, but I think this idea, the origin of this idea was okay. Vehicle to grid will be required a lot of communication between vehicles, grid, and the rest of the agents on the electric grid. So, how can we reduce the impact of recharging electric vehicles without using the electric grid, using the information of the electric grid? So we propose that because we saw that there were a lot of vehicles that usually they have enough energy to share. So the idea was to, okay, if they have a lot of energy stored in their batteries, we could use this energy to recharge the other vehicles. But it's true that in a short time, you are not able to implement that.
Okay, thank you there. Rafael has one question there. Rafael? Rafa?
Hi, first, thank you very much for the good presentation and very interesting topics. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Rafa.
Now I have a curiosity more than the question. When you speak about the methods to recharge without electrical connection by magnetic coupling, do you have some information about the incidence and influence over the health of the persons in the magnetic fields, a very hard magnetic fields?
I don't have directly information. We were working maybe 5 years ago in that problem in order to try to avoid the radiation from the coil to go up to the driver's position, and we take some measures, and the effect was not very high. But I know that the people who is developing these things, most people here in Spain, I think they are the most advanced developing project is done by people from Zaragoza, from Circe, and probably they have more information for that.
Yes, now in this moment, as you know, with the COVID pandemia, we have the bulls about the 5G's.
Yeah.
There with antennas there. I believe this is the same people that is moving this kind of thing. Probably if we use the earth to connect it, we go down and then we can connect by the earth, and then we will have direct Wi-Fi connection. We have Wi-Fi through the earth. Probably should be a solution there. Rafa will be our speaker in May, the 13th of May. Then we'll speak about PV. And all of you are invited to register for this talk. I believe we have to have a question within the chat.
Adrian.
P2P applications, factors as the state of health, yes, or the battery. You have the battery in this kind of cycling there.
Well, two things. The first one is related to the how we agree with the price. The idea is that all the drivers knows their activity 1 day ahead, so they can know when they are they will be parked and what will be the daily trip. So we can estimate a little bit how much energy they are going to use. All this information is sent to an aggregator, and the aggregator. We propose an algorithm to fix the final price. And related to the health of the battery, the point here is that you have a lot of energy stored in their batteries. So you can use, in order to charge one vehicle, you can use two, three, four different other cars. So you don't have to extract the energy from one car to the other. You can extract a little bit from this car, a little bit from the other car, and send to only one car. With this action, you reduce the impact of this, the cycling of this trading. It's the same if you are using your vehicle for frequency regulation. You are using a little bit of your capacity, but you don't discharge your battery a lot. You only are recharging a little bit. So that's the main idea.
You will be on floating all the time there.
Yeah, more or less.
This should be the idea.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. I believe it's time to finish. Thank you, Jesus, for your time.
Okay,
you have
thank you for
time now to go there.
Okay.
In the department. Thank you to all the attendees people. We reached a maximum of 72 people there. It's a real pleasure there. Thank you for the IOEQ European project, the IEEE Spanish section, and the IEEE Spanish chapter of the Education Society. And see you next week in another interesting webinar from Spain, in this case, about the cybersecurity. Bye-bye there.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.